Good morning. So this is the earliest illuminations event I've ever organized and attended. So welcome, 8:30 in the morning, bright and early. I'm Daphne Lay, professor of drama and interim director of illuminations. Today we are so grateful to have Charlotte MacGyver here. So we'll spend the next hour or so talking about sex, sexual consent, sex education, and sexual health, and the power of theater, how to use theater to address all these issues. And in this era of Me Too and Time's Up, I think this is just extremely important that we really raise awareness about all these sex-related issues, really among young people your age. And other people in the society. So Dr. Charlotte MacGyver, she's actually in Ireland right now. This is her afternoon. So this time zone works out. So she will talk about her work in the Active Consent Program. That is a project that uses live theater, radio, social media, and workshops and live theater and then real-time statistical research to actually address many aspects of sexual health. And then it's a very successful program. So it's based in the National University of Ireland in Galway, but it has been touring all over Ireland since last year. So today's talk will be from the Irish context, but then you will soon understand this is a very, very universal and very, very relatable topic. And so before we start, let me introduce Dr. Charlotte MacGyver. And she's the director of the Creative Arts and Communication Unit of this Active Consent Project. And she's a senior lecturer in drama and theater studies at the National University of Ireland, Galway, and she's a theater practitioner, as you know, an educator, and also a very, very prolific scholar. And she's the author of Migration and Performance in Contemporary Ireland Towards a New Interculturalism. And she's a co-editor of 4 books, imagine that. The first one is Interculturalism and Performance Now, New Directions, and that is with Jason King. The second one is Devised Performance in Irish Theater, Histories and Contemporary Practice, and that is with Siobhan O'Gorman. And the third one is Staging Intercultural Ireland, Place and Practitioner Perspectives, and that is with Matthew Spangler. And the last one, and my favorite, is actually co-edited with me. And it's called The Methuen Companion to Interculturalism and Performance. So before we start, as I said, I just wanna, because today we're going to talk about sex. So this is just a trigger warning. Please feel free to leave and step out if you'd rather not to hear or see some of these topics. And I'm sure your instructor will understand. And just one last note, I see some of the PhD students here. So if you would like, Dr. MacGyver will stay after the talk and chat with you. Okay. So without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Charlotte MacGyver.
So hello, everyone, and thanks so much for having me here, Daphne. It's brilliant to be here as your colleague, your collaborator, your friend. I went to UC Berkeley, go Bears, so an alumni of the California system. I have family in Orange County, and some of my best friends went to UC Irvine, so I'm really delighted to be joining you here today from the other west coast of Ireland. So what I'm going to talk to you about today is quite, I suppose, a complex and multi-tentacled project, which really began for me, I think, actually, on the campus of UC Berkeley, when I saw the term for the very first time, consent. I was walking across Sproul Plaza I saw a Planned Parenthood table, went over to donate and saw this t-shirt that said, I love consensual sex. And I said, huh, consent, what an interesting angle on these ideas about sexual violence, harassment, and so on. Now this would have been, I suppose, the early-ish 2000s or mid 2000s. So a while ago, as this dialogue was, this particular turn in the sexual violence dialogue was about to begin. So it goes back to then for me, but a longer interest in gender equality, sexuality, and so on. So the title of what I'm going to talk to you about today is The Act of Consent Program in Ireland. What's theater got to do with it? And as I spun out this talk more and more with Daphne, it then began, okay, what does Ireland have to do with consent? And how does the story of Ireland and consent coming from an American, you know, what's that about? So there's a lot of layers here to unpack together today. At some point in the presentation, I sent Daphne a video, which is an overview of the theater project just as we were about to go on tour last year. But what I'll be trying to do here today is first give you an overview of the Act of Consent project and then take you through some other layers. So just to reiterate what Daphne had said to us about there's going to be a discussion of themes more specifically related to sexual violence and content and consent in historical and contemporary contexts. For both Irish history as well as wider histories, and some images related to sexuality and the history of sex and performance. For all of you, you know, self-care is one, number one, step out or take a moment if you need. This is being recorded, so then if you want to come and look back at it, you can feel free to. And then some local support numbers on your campus I've provided to you for ease at the end of this presentation. So, active consent, who are we and what is that asterisk all about, as I always get asked, and I'm very proud of the asterisk, so I will talk to you about it. So our program supports young people 16 to 24 to have positive and confident sexual health and well-being through active consent. We work with groups that are important to young people, from teachers to parents, college staff, and policymakers. I am more or less the only person from the humanities, and more specifically theater, within our interdisciplinary team. I work with colleagues from nursing, from health promotion, from psychology, from sociology, although my creative content producer, Alex, would also be from a broadly creative arts background. A lot of artists come in and collaborate on our project, but I am living in a social scientist world a lot of the time. We use our research that Daphne mentioned, and I'll share some of the most recent stats from our national survey that we conducted last year in a moment, but we take our research and we also take our participatory work with young people, with college students, with university staff, administrators, support staff, and turn that knowledge into workshops. So there's a consent workshop that we ran in person and now have developed as an online version. We developed the play that I'll be talking to you about today. We've moved into short film, even animation within the context of the lockdown, which if you told me I'd be doing that 5 years ago, I would never have believed you. I'm not doing the animating, just leading the storytelling part of it. And then our research. So we work with everyone from small groups in workshops that were in real life pre-pandemic, larger groups in our drama presentation, which toured nationally last year, and reached over 3,000 people. Our social media and interactive video content, which is an ongoing campaign, and you'll get several shout outs to follow our socials during this talk today. And then we also prepare and train staff and youth leaders. So we're always looking to create alongside others to empower people to shape our content, to deliver the workshops or engage in talkbacks with us at the shows and so on. So we're research-based, we're collaborative, we're dynamic in what we do, or so we hope. So we just conducted, as part of our research, part of our larger research team conducted the first experience on the first survey on consent, sexual behavior, sexual violence, and harassment that had taken place in Ireland in 7 years, okay? So we do regularly engage in these kinds of statistical practices, but it hadn't happened for 7 years. I'm also really proud to say as well, you hear that the wider focus of my work on Ireland is on migration, race and ethnicity, interculturalism. This was also the first survey where we asked any any questions about people's racial and ethnic background, which in Ireland is a big step forward because there still very much is an assumption that everyone is white Irish, whereas actually 17% of our population is non-national or not having Irish or EU citizenship. So we're a very changed population in the last 25 years or so specifically, which you're going to hear played out through some of these sexual histories here in a couple of moments. So there's a lot that is very different about Ireland. However, there's also a lot that is the same or that tracks along, particularly with US statistics on sexual violence. So we found that 29% of females and 10% of males and then 28% of non-binary students reported to us non-consensual penetration or rape by incapacitation, force, or threat of force in the last year through that survey. So that's a little bit more than the 1 in 4 statistic that has been quite ubiquitous over time in the United States. And the feedback from our colleagues in other higher education institutions is some people said, is this overreporting? But a lot said to us, is it actually underreporting? Of the, of our students, only 4 in 10 students felt safe socializing at night. Unsurprisingly, women had a much lower percentage of feeling safe socializing, 69% males and 22% non-binary. That's a startling statistic and also really interesting to me because as you can tell from my accent, as I've told you, I grew up in the United States. I grew up on the East Coast. I went to grad school at Berkeley. And you know, one of the things I was struck by moving to Ireland was the much lower levels of street harassment or you're not so concerned about some of the things about harassment in my own experience, but I suppose I'm a bit older, but yet our students are coming back to us and saying that actually a very low percentage of them feels safe out at night. But there is good news in all this as well. We found that overall 75% of students agree that their peers think sexual consent is an important issue and that they want to talk about it, they want to engage with it. And over 80% of students say personally for them that it is important to talk about consent. So we're looking at very high levels of sexual violence, of harassment. We could go even further into those statistics, but I promised Daphne I wouldn't spend that long on them, especially at the beginning. But there is good news as well. So we, as a group, we are sex positive. We want to reduce violence, reduce harassment, but we also want to empower people across all genders, relationship status, whether single, whether in a couple, whether non-sexually active or sexualities, to experience their sexuality in the way that they want to consensually and safely with partners. So we want to change the bad and amplify the good in terms of what is possible for us as a community. So working as really the sole theater person and one of the only humanists as part of my team means that I do things like produce the play that we took on the national tour and which we'll get into across this presentation. But I also apply my theater skills around storytelling, around image, around leading people on a journey across the act of consent program. So two other things I'll speak to briefly to give you an example of that range. There is a series of films that we made a few years ago where you follow the stories of 3 different couples who are at the beginning of what turns into a sexual encounter. But as a viewer, you're exposed to some of our learning from the statistics about what other people in college think about what it means to go home with someone. Does that mean that you've consented to a sexual act before you even took any clothes off, for example? And we say, okay, here's the people in this situation. Here's the statistic. Now, do you think that they should go home together? Or they should call it a night? Should they get the condom? Should they, kind of change the subject? Because one of the things that I was interested in a lot of the stories or accounts that we hear of sexual violence in the media, when you hear a newspaper report after something happens, or even in a lot of plays that deal with this topic, the event has already happened and we're already divided into binaries of, victim, survivor, and perpetrator. Whereas I said, okay, what would happen if we tried to think about the way in which somebody's journey through a sexual encounter, there are choices at many different points. And we need to empower people in those choices at different points and in the language that might help you get through that particular moment. So that was a more direct application of my theater skills to the medium of film, working with filmmakers and writing the scripts and having it acted by students that I work with. a new thing that I did post-COVID was help leading the storyboarding and creation of a self-directed e-learning module on sexual violence and harassment, which also then does some work in training people on how to act as an active bystander, to speak up, to step in if you see negative things happening for yourself or for your peers. And we use some of the short film material in that. But I found myself thinking a lot in this project how all those things that you're learning, as many of you are theater students, do apply in this wider activist education context. And there's actually an open link to the sexual violence and harassment program. It's based on Irish data, because one of the other things that we deal with quite a bit is that people are always trying to sell us stuff here that is made in the UK or that is made in the States, no offense. And it's not actually, you know, Irish students' voices, it's not Irish data. Nonetheless, you may be interested to look through this, navigate, learn, and I can share that with Daphne afterwards. One of the things that's really positive about Ireland in this very moment, before we kind of go back in time a little bit, is that in 2017, we put consent into the law in terms of defining it, in terms of aid in the prosecution of sexual offenses. And there are kind of seven categories defined in which consent cannot be given, in terms of factors like extreme intoxication by drugs or alcohol and so on. But consent is in law. It is a term that has that legal currency, although that still is quite recent. We've had a very enthusiastic support of the area of consent and sex education by the two most recent, and indeed only two ever, ministers for higher education in Ireland. And the growth of the active consent program from this scrappy little project where we were writing research reports, I was not writing research reports. One day my colleague Padraig, the curly haired gentleman, gave me a call when I was a new staff member at Galway, and said, "Charlotte, you know, I'm writing these research reports. Do you think you can make a play out of a research report?" And I was like, "That's not how theater works. You need to have a bigger why than that, you know, but I can try to take what you're doing and see how to put it in conversation with the kind of theater that I want to make or the conversations that are going on in the field." We then began doing our workshops, so on. So we went from this like scrappy little operation to having the backing of the First Minister for Higher Education, Mary Mitchell O'Connor, which led to the creation of a working group in the government on consent and sexual violence in higher education. My colleague Padraig led on that committee. It resulted in the report you see below, Safe, Respectful, and Positive, which says that we had to implement sex education and consent training in particular across Irish universities. Our more recent even Minister for Higher Education, Simon Harris, has also taken up this cause. You know, like in Ireland and everywhere else, it's politics, right? Would he want to be associated with the same cause as his predecessor? And particularly in the middle of a pandemic, where I was really afraid when it started that the argument would be no one's having sex, they can't even see each other. Why would we support this area? But he's also been a very enthusiastic supporter and recently launched our toolkit, which is an overview of our research, our findings, our approach, which you can download for free on our website. And I'll tell you where that is later. So we're in this like really unique position in Ireland where we were a scrappy team working on a bunch of things. We hit the zeitgeist and have kind of continued to not coast on that, but grow. And really, but the thing that I learned again and again about activism, about advocacy, is that it's constant work. Even when you get to a certain level in a small country like Ireland, the job is still not done. Before I kind of launched the rest of our journey today, now that you have some sense of what active consent is, and on that asterisk, the reason that we wanted it there is because what we're doing is always spinning out. It's always developing. It's a little bit of a nerdy thing where it's almost like a footnote, where it says, okay, we're gonna be active around consent, we're gonna be active around changing sexual attitudes, we're gonna be inclusive across genders, relationships, sexualities, but how do we know when our work ended? We have to keep adding, we have to keep spinning out, and we have to work as a team. So as I am in this team, a larger team, I wanna give special thanks today to James Bigley, who's a PhD student working with me particularly in the arts area, Padraig McNeela and Siobhan O'Higgins, who are the two other co-principal investigators on this, Laura Tierney and Rebecca Conley, who did a lot of the heavy lifting on some of the statistical research that you're gonna hear about even more so later in the presentation around the play. And it has been incredibly exciting and enlightening to work as part of a bigger team like that. So I've already told you a lot. And for y'all, it's like 8:45 in the morning, and I hope you've had coffee. But in even beginning to unpack that much and thinking what it would be like for you to hear about it at 8:40 in the morning, and from Ireland, I realized that we had to kind of kick it back even further to think about this role of sex politics in theater over time. Why did Padraig even think it was a good idea to pick up the phone and call me and ask me to turn his play, his research report into a play? And I want to draw some very direct connections there to the work that I know that many of you are doing in theater histories right now with Daphne. I know you've just looked at Liz Estrada. So we got to go back to the Greeks there to talk for a moment. We're also going to look at the history of sex in Ireland then and now. And there are some incredibly striking contexts, contrasts, I suppose, from where I'm sitting today in 2020 to even 30 years prior. And some of this may be news to some of you or not to others, given the kind of global attention paid, particularly to some recent referendums that we've had. We'll also look at the very central role of artists in advancing and stimulating debate on social issues, historical and contemporary, in Ireland. You can really see this at the center of the pulse of Ireland and of some of the very key moments that I'm going to talk to briefly, which I think is really inspiring, particularly having grown up in the States, having lived there for most of my life. I know sometimes things can feel so big, and that idea of kind of getting to a center of power or having any kind of voice or presence in a discourse can be very alienating. So when I think about the proximity between artists and the kind of important social change that has happened within the last 10 years, particularly, I'm really inspired by that and want to give that over to you as well. I'm then going to go really broad again to actually, you know, use this experience with active consent and those other moments to talk about, like, how do we know theater works, right? Because me trying to make social change through theater, me making an argument that artists really have something to say and are at the center of social change in Ireland today, at least in the images that circulate after the fact of important contemporary historical moments, there's a supposition there that, like, well, when we take up doing a piece of art, that it has some work that it can do. So I want us to think through that a little bit, and then we will get back to the play. Daphne's like, can you just talk about the play? Like, let's just show the play. And I was like, no, Daphne, like, it's bigger. We're gonna go broader than that. But then we will go back to the play to end the point there at the end. And maybe when we get to that point, Daphne, I'll have you play the little clip of the video. So, sex in the theater. You know, often in theater history classes, we begin with the Greeks and then immediately problematize it in terms of all the other theater cultures, performance practices that we do not have on record and so on. So that being said, when we think about the Greek theater, particularly as being one of the originary theater and performance cultures in the world and having the texts that remain, such as Liz Estrada, we see the inextricability of sex and theater. Liz Estrada is literally about the withholding of sex in order to achieve a political aim. And that play itself and its adaptation and its reproduction over time has continually taken up this idea of using this debate over or examination of sex in the theater to accomplish other kinds of political change. I'm thinking of the Liz Estrada Project, which was founded, I believe, in around, was it 2007, and involved theater companies, women, single artists around the world doing readings or productions of Liz Estrada in order to protest the Iraq War. So it lives in all those ways, and it's very on the nose about sex. But then, as I always try to wake people up when I'm teaching about the Seder plays and Greek theater in other 8:30 a.m. theater classes elsewhere in the world, you know, we would go to the Greek theater, we would see these plays about power, about gender, although performed all by men, sometimes literally about sex in the way that Liz Estrada is. But then we would have the Seder plays as the palate cleanser in between, satirizing what just came before. And one of the big kind of visual features of those was the wearing of the phalluses, yeah? By the comic actors, which I did not make up. It is there on the Greek vases, as we see in a scene from actually not a Seder play, but Aristophanes' comedy, The Birds. So sex and theater have been entangled in many of the originary narratives of certainly Western theater, but I think world theater as well. And when I teach Greek theater, I love to think or to riff on the translation of theatron as the seeing place, that within the Greek theater as a paradigm, we have this very direct relationship, this conscious relationship between theater and politics in terms of the funding, in terms of the subject matter of the play, in terms of what the audience gathering together was meant to do as a performative act. But I would argue, you know, sex and sex as in sexual intercourse, but sex as in gender broadly construed is also inextricably part of this. And so for me, when Daphne said, you know, you're going to be talking about this in the context of the Greeks, I thought, well, of course, like it kind of does go back there if you follow one thread of narratives through history. And I would also warn y'all, the theater history students, that the reason I'm standing here talking to you today or sitting is because of my own theater history class, where that idea, the theater, the art form that I loved and that I want to practice could actually intervene in political histories or serve as that petri dish for things to come to pass. It's the reason why I decided that I wanted to become a theater historian and a scholar practitioner more specifically. So theater, sex, politics, intertwined. Why I'm interested in using theater to work on these issues of consent and sex education in Ireland. But what am I up against? And like, what is the history in which I'm doing this practice? Because theater never happens in a background, in a backdrop. I am American, but my father was born and raised in Ireland, born in the 1950s, emigrated when he married my mom. The Ireland that I sit in, where I'm running around talking about sexuality and positive sexuality in an open way, is very different from the country that my father and my family grew up in the previous generation and previous generations to that. So historically, we were a former British colony. We achieved our independence in 1922. Although at that moment we were partitioned into the Republic and Northern Ireland, which has led to ongoing unrest, which had a high point with the Troubles, a period that you may have heard about, involving contestation between those who are loyalist slash Protestant, in other words, from tracing their lineage back to the British origin versus Northern Irish Catholic, who would align themselves with being Native Irish, although in fact everyone has lived in that area for generations, okay? So our independence is not that long. I mean, it's less than 100 years ago, and we're coincidentally in what we call the decade of commemorations, where we have been revisiting many of the key founding events of Irish history, but having really contemporary political debates and things happen around them as well. So for example, when we had our 1916 Rising, which is our Irish Independence Day celebrations, our National Theatre, the Abbey, released a program of plays, which had out of quite an extensive program, only one female playwright doing an adaptation of a play by a man on the smaller stage, and it was a play for children. This prompted a wider reckoning and movement within the Irish theater industry called Waking the Feminists, which is demanding 50-50 gender equality on stage in Ireland, as well as attention to other issues around identity and representation, which has had a ripple effect within the wider creative industries. But just, I suppose, to make the point that we're a young country, we're continuously reflecting on our history in both a backward-looking way, but when we look back, we're always trying to look forward as well. We had been colonized a long time, folks, since 1169, the British had been there. And we got rid of the British, no offense, they're great. But then really, you know, the enemy in many ways became ourselves within Ireland, and particularly the Catholic state, Catholic Church, except that's a Freudian slip, which is quite accurate. The Catholic Church had quite a direct role in the operation of state up through really the 1990s in Ireland. And this is what I mean about there being this huge sea change within the last generation. And this manifested in extreme control of women's bodies and reproductive freedom in particular. A familiar theme, unfortunately, particularly in the US today. One of the really concrete examples of this, which is a history that I think has become more globally known in the last 5 to 10 years, is that particularly in the post-independence period, there was an acceleration in the number of unmarried mothers who were incarcerated in what were called Magdalen laundries, which were run by religious orders, and also state-run mother and baby homes, with mothers taken into these homes, sometimes mostly pregnant women, but sometimes even people who had just been sexually active or who had some other kind of antisocial stigma attached to them. Perhaps, you know, some people had learning, you know, different kinds of disabilities, but predominantly pregnant women. And children were then adopted out, often against those women's will, again, as late as the 1990s. The last Magdalene Laundry only closed its doors in 1996. So we can let that sink in for a moment. We only decriminalized homosexuality in 93. We only legalized divorce in 96, the second time around. And then post-independence, birth control was not fully legalized until 1985. So that is not that long ago. And there is then this strange disconnect, particularly now teaching here in the university for almost a decade, that the students that I have in class have grown up in a very different Ireland. And even their parents, more and more, were born into an Ireland where birth control was legal, divorce was legal, et cetera. Well, maybe not their parents were born in, but the students today, you know, that reality feels very, very far away from them. And as a bit of a tiny aside, I did an adaptation of Spring Awakening, the play by Frank Wedekind, which is about sexual discovery, you know, young people coming of age, et cetera, with our students a few years ago. And I expected them to want to take up some of these histories in Ireland and dramatize them in making an Irish version of Spring Awakening. And they did not. They felt like it wasn't their history, even though it was the history of their mothers and their grandmothers. So that's perhaps a very powerful contradiction. So as these histories of the Magdalene Laundries, mother and baby homes have become more known, we know things like there were at least 30,000 women, if not more, incarcerated in Magdalene Laundries. There has been a case that's gotten a lot of global attention of the Tuam mother and baby's home, Bon Secours, where up to 800, or numbers around 796 remains of children were allegedly found on that site. And there was a much higher than usual an infant death rate at that institution during that time between 1925 and 1961. So again, post-independence, we can't blame the British for it. You know, and these moments of revelation of those particular gendered histories and sexual histories, you know, coincide almost exactly with the beginning of shifts in law around homosexuality, abortion, and so on. So there's just some, you know, and I'll give this to Daphne afterwards so people want to look deeper into this history to see, you know, so you have this pattern of discoveries of remains being found, the setting up of commissions on sexual abuse, because there's also the whole part of the story which would also be about sexual abuse by the clergy and within other religious institutions. So it's an ugly and recent history that we're really reckoning with. Still as a community, it's in living memory. The Commission for Investigations into Mother and Baby Homes in particular, only this week, there's a huge debate in the press because the recommendation of the commission was that the mother and baby home documents should be sealed for 30 years, meaning that children whose mothers were in those institutions would not have access to them, meaning that basically, you know, this generation would die without ever having had those histories come to light. And that's not actually the wish of survivors. So we're literally debating that this week in terms of what do we do with this history? And when you think about the existence of a program like Active Consent, contemporaneous to us still living with these histories and the recentness of those dates, it's a little bit mind-boggling, actually. It's also really important to say, as I said, the other area of my research looks at migration and race and ethnicity within Irish society. And, you know, this is a newer history for us in terms of the big jumps in numbers, but also not really. And the history of the mother and baby homes and the Magdalene Laundries is also a history of racialization. So there was a report that was not published, even though it was submitted to the Minister for Children on the racialized experiences of children and mothers within these mother and baby homes, because we would have had small number of minority ethnic people living in Ireland, particularly medical students, doctors coming to Ireland over decades. So you'll see here, quote, in echoes of the systemic racial segregation in the apartheid era of South Africa, mothers who are members of the mixed race community within the various institutions report how on the one hand they were racially profiled and their children were eugenically rated for likely intelligence based in part of the nuns' assessments of the intelligence of the natural mother and, quote, how, quote, negroid the features of the infant were. So again, these institutions were in operation up through the 1990s. And this is an archival picture from the mixed Irish Facebook group who have done a lot in terms of advocating in this area, in terms of pulling these kinds of images out of the archive and to make these histories visible. So although we have a much more diverse Irish population now, we have not yet really reckoned with these. So what are we doing in the arts then? I mean, you may have come across some of these works like Philomena, which was billed as a romantic comedy, somehow a little bit with the shamrock up there on the screen, which was a film released in the early 2010s involving Philomena, the mother, and her son finding her after she had been in a mother and baby home, the film The Magdalene Sisters. Within Ireland, these histories have more and more become the concern of theater artists. There was a quite influential site-specific and immersive theater production staged in a former Magdalene laundry, which you can see here below on Gloucester Street in Dublin. It was the last laundry that closed its doors in 1996, and the doors had not been opened prior to the theater company gaining access to do that production in 2011. So we're trying to work these histories out through art, both in an international and a national context. If you're wondering what theater artists had to say about this stuff before the contemporary, you can also see the sexual anxiety that ran through Irish society in various ways due to the relationship of church and state through several kind of key moments. One being the very famous riot surrounding a production of John Millington Synge's Playboy of the Western World. Chances are, if you know one historical Irish play, you probably know this play. It's a kind of popular crowd pleaser now about a scrappy outsider who pretends to kill his father, comes into a town, romances the woman who's the daughter of the man who runs the pub, and it all seems like it goes bad, and then it goes okay, but then it ends semi-tragically. This play was very controversial at the time that it premiered due to the language that was used within it, which was felt to be coarse by certain factions of the kind of nationalist Irish political scene who felt like it reflected badly on Ireland at a moment where we were trying to show that we were civilized to the British. And in particular, the famous story is that the riot started at the moment where Christie talks, the main character talks about wanting to see women in their shifts, which meant underwear. So see all the ladies in their lingerie, and this prompted riots within the theater. Later in the century, 50 years later, almost to the day, there was a controversy where we were doing a production of Tennessee Williams' The Rose Tattoo at a theater in Dublin called the Pike Theater, which was experimental, which did international work. There was a rumor that a contraceptive had been dropped on stage, a condom, because contraceptives were not legal in Ireland. Interestingly, they again became illegal after independence and then remained so until the 1980s. And on this suspicion, which was not substantiated, the co-founder of the theater, Alan Simpson, was arrested during the performance, and the subsequent legal fallout had serious consequences for himself and his partner, Carol Simpson, and led to the folding of the company. So again, we can look to the stage, that place where these relationships between theater and politics and sex is being worked out quite actively. Jump to sex in Ireland now. You have me talking to you about active consent. You also have us in 2015 becoming the first country to legalize marriage equality by a popular vote. And then in 2018, we legalized abortion by a 66.4% majority through repeal of the Eighth Amendment, which had previously said that the mother's life was equal to that of the unborn child. So the striking down of that and the procuring of abortion up to 12 weeks free through the state and through local medical care was a major step. It's also important to say that with the marriage equality referendum, you see here Panty Bliss, Rory O'Neill, who is a drag queen, theater maker, entrepreneur, activist, who became the kind of beating heart of the marriage equality campaign and one of its most public faces and agitators. And again, he's coming out of the kind of fringes of club culture up through the theater and then becomes like Ireland's hero, the Queen of Ireland, people call Panty. That's a remarkable journey within only a little bit over 20 years. And indeed, Panty's role at the center of the marriage equality campaign, you know, can be traced to many parts of her history as an activist and a public figure. But in particular, she had experienced a defamation suit after calling the actions of an extremist organization in Ireland homophobic on RTE, our national public TV and radio station. She was sued for defamation, for calling out actions as homophobic under our defamation laws, underwent a lengthy legal battle, and then came to the stage in 2014 during a production of a play called The Risen People, which was an early 20th century work that was adapted for the stage. And at the end of it, and again, this is about how we connect the historical and the contemporary in Ireland, we asked leading figures to come to the stage and give a noble call at the end of the play. The play had been about labor struggle in 1914 in Ireland, and Panty came and talked about homophobia in Ireland, inequality. The video went viral and was a really pivotal moment in garnering more sympathetic public support for the marriage equality referendum. Equally, the iconography of the Repeal the Eighth movement, the role of a group called the Artists' Campaign to Repeal the Eighth Amendment, hugely influential in the kind of images that we use to talk about what we experience, the kind of energy in the ongoing marches. And it's important to say, particularly with the Repeal the Eighth movement, that built on decades of activism, okay? There were people in their 30th year of campaigning for the right to abortion in Ireland who eventually led that appeal to that amendment to pass. But you know, it's quite incredible to think that when a country thinks about these moments, they look to the theater, they look to visual arts, they look to poetry in quite concrete ways. Looking back across the Atlantic, I mean, I find it quite surreal that I am living in a country that has gone through this kind of seismic change in 20, 25 years, and looking back across the country at the kind of political theater of the confirmation of Amy Coney Barrett, ongoing, happening as we speak. And you can see the resonances between how we use the power of image and performance within activist contexts in terms of abortion, particularly in the US, but we could also look at Black Lives Matter. I'm repeatedly struck by the role of Osseo Patrice as a performance artist, as well as one of the lead co-founders of that movement. So what has happened in Ireland over these past 20 years is inspiring. It drives home the role of the arts. But I would also say that as we continue to negotiate what is changing politics in the States today, you know, we can maybe call on these examples and wonder what we can learn from them. So in thinking about all that, the history that I've inherited, that I'm living through, working on this program, what I come back to is this question of how do we know theater works? And maybe, you know, for those of you tuning in this morning across broad theatrical backgrounds or artistic backgrounds, maybe you're obsessed with it too. So I come back a lot to a binary of this idea of efficacy and entertainment. So within theater and performance studies, efficacy, when we know something works, has been sometimes opposed or taken up as opposed to entertainment, such as in Richard Schechner's studies of ritual versus theatrical functions of a performance over time. And we've been nuancing this kind of divide ever since. However, you know, Baz Kershaw, now more than 20 years ago, talked about efficacy as, quote, the potential that theater may have to make the immediate effects of performance influence, however minutely, the general historical evolution of wider social and political realities. So when we look at Panty on that stage doing the noble call at the end of a performance at the Abbey, Ireland's National Theatre, and I tell you that that was a moment that caused a wider ripple effect that helped with the passing of the amendment to the Constitution, that is efficacy in a kind of more cut and dry way than we're used to seeing. But efficacy, I suppose, making sure the performance can work, can also be a major, quote, arena for the reinforcement and or the recovering of hegemony. And what he means by that is that theater and the power that it could have can be directed towards negative or positive ideological ends. But yet we remain obsessed with this idea of efficacy, I think, particularly as anyone who is a politically engaged theater artist. And you can see this across fields that we might name theater for social change, political theater, educational and or applied theater and performance made with communities for communities, into which I would place the kinds of sex you might have at college as a project. We want to know and to think and to find and to evidence that theater has an embodied and live potential to do good as a site of transformation. Stephanie Etheridge Woodson and Tamara Underminer recently put it in their 2018 edited collection, Theater, Performance, and Change. Change is the prerogative, quote, of artistic innovation, the imperative of activist performance, the goal of our teaching, and the implicit object of theater and performance historical studies. And to that I say, yeah, hell yes. You know, in my own contribution to the Active Consent Program as a theater scholar practitioner, I'm driven precisely daily to apply that to what we're doing. But how do I know that we're doing that? So the social change specifically that we're trying to pursue through our producing of the play, The Kinds of Sex You Might Have at College for Irish college audiences, is measurable change in levels of what we've called consent literacy. Didn't make that up, people. By those who engage with the play or indeed also our workshops, this is then numerically supported evidence we've done good via theater. For our team, consent literacy, which we've taken from health promotion literature, from health literacy and health promotion literature, would be achieved if after engaging with our play and or our workshop or the other campaigns or things I've told you, an individual came out of that with more information, measurable confidence to act, communication and engagement skills, and also help seeking and signposting capacity, the awareness, knowledge, and confidence to access support services personally or to assist others in doing so. So then we're left with the question, okay, that's where we know we want to get, but how do you design art to accomplish that? And how do we know that we get there? So in 2016, we had designed what we called a consent preparedness scale that we used to evaluate across our workshops and our play so that we could make comparative evaluation of efficacy between the two measures. So it has 6 items. I have all the skills I need to deal with for sexual consent. I find it difficult to talk about sexual consent with an intimate partner. I would be confident talking about sexual consent, et cetera. So it's kind of measuring more preparedness, less preparedness. And actually that's the version with more than 6. I apologize. When we do these surveys as well, which happen before and after you do the workshop or see the play, you also are asked for demographic information, and there is a free comments section there. And the play questionnaire also includes a different, and I'll show you in a moment, more specific number base scale on consent preparedness, which is influenced by the play content. And there it is, actually. So we're looking, you know, this was responding then to what additional layers or issues came up in the play as compared to the workshop. So then we get results where we're able to look at, okay, what does the drama do in terms of shifting attitudes or awareness versus the workshop? And one of the things that really stood out to me there in the bolded statistics is that almost 10% more students said that the drama showed them or modeled ways to do good communication with a sexual partner, which is not surprising, right? Because drama, one of the things that drama can do is hold a mirror up to real life. But that's not all it can do, which is a point that I'll return to in the final movement of the presentation. But I think this is where my social scientist colleague got very interested in working with a theater person because of this role of modeling within that we can do together. And so then what we're always doing is going for a blend of evaluative measures. This is what we would call the quantitative. It's based on numbers. But we also work with the qualitative, which is a description of people's experiences of the play. So that may come out of the free comments, that also may come out of focus group interviews that we do, and so on. When I looked as a theater scholar practitioner at how other projects that are similar to mine internationally utilize theater to affect change and how they measure the efficacy, is that there usually is more weight based on these kinds of quantitative number-based methods of analysis.
And there are really important reasons for number-based methods of analysis, particularly in the Trumpian so-called post-truth era. However, I also remain curious and often maybe, you know, I don't remember the word, curious, let's say, about how the qualitative and theoretical methods offered by theater and performance studies might offer us different alternatives to understanding how the play or other interventions from our own project or those other social movements I've mentioned achieve efficacy within broader social contexts. And also just as urgently, the limits of attributing efficacy to our interventions quantitatively or qualitatively. I could be the best sexual health consent program in the world. I'm not going to solve sexual violence on my own. So measures of efficacy in our field may heavily weight firsthand experiences of individuals, including ourselves as a scholar practitioner or groups, which sometimes means that the way that I talk about things, my colleagues say, you know, is this analytically sound or is this biased? However, I think what we do really well as a field is pay that rigorous attention to material and historical context, as well as the dramaturgical and effective dimensions of genre and structure as intended by the theater makers and experienced by our audiences in dialogue with those other contexts, immediate and past, as I've just sketched to you in terms of my potted history of the sexual history of Ireland. And I find that this kind of attention to context and form could be engaged more robustly sometimes in the sciences, in the social sciences. So theater and performance studies, I think, give us more analytical space for scholars to explore the haunted resonances and byproducts of a theatrical performance or process that might not be captured as easily or as readily as outcomes via scales. As an art form, our work, which has more than one strict interpretation in its images, stories, and character perspectives, which is a deliberately interpretive flexibility that is a distinguishing feature of the play, The Kinds of Sex You Have in College, but is also, you know, a feature of wider things we've created for active consent. I think that has meaning and that has power and that we need it. We also need the urgently complicated and nuanced analytical methodologies to understand the impact of our workshops, but the logic, the efficacy, and the historical situatedness of the forms and strategies that we employ in making our theater also need to be taken seriously. This is something people have thought about quite a lot within theater and performance studies, the limits of drawing conclusions from what we rehearse in a theater or in a rehearsal room. So Dani Snyder-Young in her book, Theater, The Theater of Good Intentions, talks about how actions taken within a fiction world are taking place in relationship to imaginary constraints. Can they really be lived? You know, how long does that impact last afterwards? Helen Nicholson says that it's often difficult to gauge the social effects of drama immediately. And when I read that participants having expressed profound changes in attitudes, I often wonder in whether they've been complicit in following the script of the workshop or whether their change of heart indicates a positive but temporary identification with a kindly practitioner. So that kind of more temporary change, you know, can be reflected quite well in the surveys that we do after the performance of The Kinds of Sex You Might Have in College. But how do we really know what work it does on this wider problem of sexual violence? To attend to that, something that we have started experimenting with is doing longer follow-up surveys after the performance or after experience of our workshop, and we'll eventually extend it to looking at other parts of our campaign as well. And we do see that there is a lasting impact of thinking further on about what they experienced and in terms of how they're dealing with sexual consent in their daily lives. But again, you know, is this, I suppose, responding to or playing to the test, or is it a genuine, I suppose, sustainability of the shift in perspective? I've been recently quite inspired by the work of Marcela Fuentes in Performance Constellations and thinking about my own conundrum around efficacy and the kinds of sex you might have in college, but also about, you know, activism and protest more generally. She talks about how activists, artists, and protesters in Latin America interweave on and offline modalities of cooperative action in order to challenge the status quo and affect social change. So it's not about the one theater production, the one noble call that Panchi does, the one protest that you attend as part of the Repeal the Eighth movement, but about these continuous ongoing actions. So for her, thinking about performance constellations illuminates the role of performance as a means of, quote, producing collectivity from temporal and spatial fragmentations, similar to the way the constellations give shape to clusters of stars that exist in different times and different proximities. So we have to keep doing all the things, even as we get tired, in a way that is, quote, episodic and multi-layered, a method of facilitating the emergence of what is imminent, unexplored, or occluded. So how does keeping working at a problem deliver more of these layers? So like that asterisk of act of consent, what other footnotes or continuation do we need? And you can see some of this play out in real time through how we approach, say, our Instagram accounts and our socials as the way that we continue the conversation with our followers and the way in which the different threads of the program come together. I'm going to zoom in here really quickly then on how all this thinking and history then plays out in the dramaturgical structure of the play, The Kinds of Sex You Might Have at College. It has been in development since 2014. I've written the play collaboratively with groups of students who change every year in response to what statistics are coming out of the act of consent research. What are the social contexts in terms of, say, the Me Too movement, in terms of the kinds of historical events or contexts that I've talked to you about in this talk today. So it's a piece of theater that is constantly evolving, that very consciously does not follow four characters from beginning to end, but has an ensemble of four actors playing different characters intentionally all the time. Sometimes somebody is a perpetrator, sometimes somebody is a survivor of sexual violence. There are scenes that are quite positive around sexuality. There are scenes that explore the darker themes as well. And what the intention really is there is to try to get people to see the different positions that we're going to take up over the course of our lifetime, and also to bring that proximity of these issues to people, because even if you may not be a survivor, somebody close to you is. The fact is that with these high prevalences of sexual violence, it's likely that someone you know or that is connected to you may be a perpetrator. So how do we dramatize that on the stage? So we say it's a play about what you want, how you want it, if you want it, and what happens when you don't. And so here's just a few images from the production of the four actors who starred in the original tour of the play. You know, in terms of our definition of consent, which I actually haven't defined for you, over the years and through workshopping with students and through study of the law in Ireland and so on, we've come up with the acronym OMFG, Act of Consent. It's ongoing, it's mutual, and it's freely given. You know, there have been many acronyms attempted around sexual consent, Planned Parenthood, FRIES, freely given, retractable. I forget the I and the E. So, but that is ours, the OMFG. We're taking a page here from Bertolt Brecht, certainly in the structural form of the play. As I said, that impulse not to just have characters to identify with from beginning to end, but to show us all how character changes over a day, a lifetime, 4 years of college was very intentional. We wanted to keep the audience guessing, on their feet, throughout, self-critical. But and in this as well, we sought to do something that I hadn't seen in other plays around sexual violence and assault, particularly in the United States during the time that I lived there, which was to broaden normative representations of assault, to really centralize the perspectives of LGBTIQ plus characters and voices within the wider play, which we do, to also look at sexual violence happening within a relationship. And in this scene that you see from the play right here, in fact, it is the female in the relationship who is an aggressor with their long-term partner, but really passing off the kind of language or strategies being used as, oh, well, he's just not being that much of a man. Like, I had to push it, you know. So trying to get the audience to look critically at the kinds of sexual violence or behaviors that we might look past. But the result of this then, particularly within the social sciences heavy team, is that sometimes the ambiguity, like in the scene I've just cited, or like in, I think, what is our most popular scene in the play, popular or head scratching or challenging scene, One Event, Many Perspectives, that scene takes four friends who had been on a night out. Two of the friends go home together and have a sexual encounter that turns out not to have been consensual between the man and the woman that you see on the screen here. However, both are confused about what happened, about what consent means, about whether they did something wrong, whether something happened. You have all these processes of the kind of self-reflection, the blaming, the denial, the lack of understanding that we're really playing out here in front of audiences. To get them to think about, okay, what are things that we've written off? Do we really know what consent is? What have you? But one of my colleagues wrote to me right before doing this focus groups and said, I'm just wondering what you intended by that scene. Was it framed by a view of non-consent as a product of misread cues or something to do with unequal power dynamics? Or was it meant to be unclear whether a rape happened at all? So we're back to this, you know, what box does it fit in? Where is it on the scale? And for me, what was productive was the ambiguity, was the fact that that was the first scene that everyone's talked about, asked about at the talkbacks that we had after every performance of the play. You had dramatic techniques in that scene, such as the character of the survivor and the perpetrator saying, I hate myself for allowing this to happen. I hate myself for being this person, showing the way in which language can be so tricky and confusing in terms of working through both of those perspectives. So in then the focus groups that we did, as well in feedback from other team members, including my PhD student who came on after this was created to evaluate it, he echoed my feeling that what was most effective, in my opinion, was the uncertainty in many of the scenes. And one of our focus group participants said, you're getting two sides of the story. It's not black and white. So I think that's probably the most powerful thing. Both people hold a responsibility to communicate and voice if they're unwilling to do something, and on in terms of the nuance or the layers in what people said and how they debated this particular scene. So as I think about the role of theater in conversations around social change, around sexual violence, more broadly, you know, it is one of our most important tools within, I suppose, the history of performing arts and of culture. It can also be seductive in the sense that we think we do the play, someone fills out a questionnaire very well, and then we're like, okay, we've chipped away, we're going to satisfy the funders and go on with the rest of our lives. But it's not that simple either. And so that's where I find myself these days really thinking most with Marcela Fuentes in terms of, okay, how is the constellation of action that we undertake as activists, as educators, as theater artists, contributing to or pushing forward a goal over time in a more complex way? That being said, at the end of the day, as I sometimes say to my team members, but I'm a drama lecturer, I'm a theater person. So I'm also inspired and hold the quote of Jill Dolan, that the experience of performance and the intellectual, spiritual, and affective traces it leaves behind can provide new frames of reference for how we see a better future extending out from our ordinary lives. Seeing that vision, we might figure out how to achieve it outside the fantastical, magical space of performance, end quote. But I would say that in order to achieve it, we got to keep working across the constellation on all the different fronts. Thank you. So I think Daphne's going to take it back over for questions.
So stop sharing your screen.
Okay.
Should we play that little video?
Yeah, let's go ahead and do that.
Yeah, let's do that. Yeah. So they will get a little bit of a better idea of, you know, not just pictures, but also.
I think I confused Daphne because we were going to play it at the beginning and then
I think that was. That's
right. Now you can see it. Great. Perfect. And what Daphne's about to show is an overview of the project done by RTE News right before we premiered the play. So we were in dress rehearsals at this point.
I froze. I couldn't move. Ice formed in my veins, making me freeze, making me ache, making me tremble.
No, 25% of 15 to 17 year olds are sexually active, and that number jumps to 85% by the age of 18.
That is a lot of awkward sex.
Yeah, but the kinds of sex you might have at college.
A complicated area that is fundamental to who we are as humans needs to have a conversation and a set of conversations around it that is complex, that is engaging, and that can really help us change some of the more problematic statistics that we've seen now over generations around sexual assault and rape within Ireland.
We had no sexual education workshops or any sort of classes like this. So for a lot of people like me, everything we learned was just from each other, from movies, from the internet.
I think it just leaves the individual to have to try and come to a conclusion by themselves. And without the information, it can be difficult to realize what's right, what's wrong, or what's needed to be discussed.
You know, sex is very much prevalent amongst young people, but yet we don't have the resources to kind of understand, like, what is safe sex, what is healthy sex, what is sex where you walk away without regret.
Men that I know would have absolutely no idea about the encounters that women have to deal with, possibly on a daily basis, a weekly basis, but everyone has something of a story. I think from most of my girlfriends or my group of friends, most of us have a story, mostly negative. And it affects all of us, you know? It doesn't just affect that one person. It affects the friends, the family, the boyfriends, the whoever. So it's a trickle-down effect, and that's why I think consent is really something that we need to be talking about.
Found a very neat slogan within the Active Consent Program, which is the consent, it's ongoing, it's mutual, it's freely given.
Ongoing means it's constantly going. You can't constantly have to check. It's mutual, so both people are actively involved with it, and it's freely given, which means that you're not coerced into doing something, or you're not afraid to do it, or, you know, you're not influenced into having sex.
I think consent can be a very sexual thing, and this idea that you both know what each other want. This idea of guessing and trying to figure out what someone is into is kind of an impossible riddle, whereas just asking, are you okay with this? Is this something we can try? I want this. That engagement will bring a far more intimate connection.
Thief, I actually will remember this in the morning, because who'd want to forget, kind?
The really great kind!
So let me see if I can see the chat box here. Well, thanks so much. I realized that went a little bit longer than I thought. There was so much history and things to kind of to bring us into. So.
Yeah, so we'll have questions. We'll have a little bit of time. How should we do this? Should we?
I can't. So if you want it, do you have any questions, Daphne? I can't see the chat box right now because the screen is.
Somebody in the chat asked where we can see the play.
So I told Daphne that I will give her a link to a recording of it. I was such a diva with Daphne because, as all the theater students know, theater never looks quite as good on film, and we had to shoot it from far back in the theater and it wasn't mic'd, but I can give a link, or I can also give access to the script of it if people are interested. So I'll pass those along to her. If you like it, do a performance of it in the States, you know. So if people are interested, I'm happy to share that.
Yeah, and then I think you say you also have, I mean, you can also share with us some of the modules and
think, yeah, so I can share the module that we've done. Also, let me go, if I share my screen, I can bring you into the end of my presentation, and we have like our social media handles, the, where did it go? The, well, basically we're just active consent on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. You can watch the shorter films there, and Instagram, where we're putting out research statistics, resources around conversation with partners and everything every day. We'll be looking at stealthing at the end of this week in terms of sexual violence. So it's based on Irish statistics, but I still think relevant to everyone living in California, particularly someone who lived in California for many years. So. And maybe someday after the pandemic, Daphne will have me come over and bring it to you all, which would be great. Wow. Now looking at all that footage and seeing all the touching, I'm like, oh my God, everyone's touching each other. This is a different time, people, a different time.
Hi, Daphne, can I make a comment?
Yes.
Yeah. Hello, Charlotte. Thank you so much for your presentation. It was really very, very instructive. And also, I think for drama people or theater people, you know, to see how theater can play a role in this kind of education. So my sort of broad question was, you know, if this sort of model is taken up, you know, it would be very complicated to try and recreate. I mean, you beautifully created the history of Irish theater and where sex figured, you know, of the plays. So to do something similar in the US would take quite a team of researchers and, you know, to actually pull this together, like then and now, even if you go back to the 1950s until kind of today. Because I think for college students also, there isn't always a sense of history that they are aware of, you know. Mostly things begin like soon, like around the time they were born kind of thing.
And it's the same in Ireland, kid, too. You know, like they don't feel like these histories that I'm telling you guys to make it clear, the kind of jump, you know, it's often news to our students as well.
Yeah, that's very true. Maybe it's a generational issue that is before us. And also the interface with social science that you do so well, you know. I mean, that is always a challenge to someone like myself, you know, how to kind of work with the data and be the humanist and all of that. So maybe you can share some comments on that or.
Yeah, so I suppose, I'm sorry, I'm like hyped, remember it's the end of my day, so I'm like so hyped up on coffee and excited to be talking to you. One of the big advantages of moving to Ireland, or that is I found really exciting, was how close you are to the nerve center of everything, like the fact that I know the Minister of Education is insane. However, if I were to think about this at a US level, you know, the work or the centers of action are much more regional, localized to universities or communities. My colleague, Mark Rich at Cal State Long Beach, has a theater troupe called the Interact Theater Troupe, which works through Augusta Boal's methods of forum theater and does stuff on sexual violence. They've moved into looking at issues related to the ongoing protests and of course, decades-long social movement for racial justice in the States as well. But he is centered within his university. He's collaborated a bit with social scientists. He at one point had a contract with the US Navy, and they were doing sexual violence prevention forum theater in naval bases, including Guantanamo, and really in these kind of ambiguous kind of ethical spaces, trying to do good or to exert good. So I think this stuff is happening over the United States. I know there's a theater troupe at Rutgers that also looks at this. You know, there's projects throughout the US, but I mean, in terms of the particularly dynamic relationship between social sciences, theater, and then government policy, yeah, we are in a pretty unique position. And we are thinking, I suppose, about how to not franchise that model, but how, like what we can learn from it. One of the best parts for me has been being able to give employment to my former students, has being able to upskill students who are now helped me contribute to like the e-learning module that we just did and so on. You know, I think particularly in a post-COVID arts landscape, which was already precarious, you know, thinking, and for many of us who are politically and socially minded, being able to extend these skills into other industries and projects, you know, there's potential there, but it's hard, guys. Kitu, I'm telling, like, my social scientist colleagues, I'm sure I drive them crazy. I'm like, efficacy, let's talk about theater, you know, and they're like, well, where are the numbers? But in those uncomfortable spaces, you know, good can happen, but it is a practice of staying with it. And I would love to bring it to the States, Elisa. I really want to come see you all and bring this, because in a way I also tried to build what I didn't feel like I saw or didn't feel like was possible in the States, but it's an ongoing project.
Yeah, unfortunately we are at time. So I'm sure everyone is really inspired and wanna really, you know, think about what we can do with theater, what we can use theater to change the world. And this is just one of the most important topics that we're dealing with today in today's political climate. And yeah, so thank you all. Thank you for participation. I hope you will be thinking about this topic. And then I will get more information from Charlotte. I will share with your instructors.
And just to say briefly to Max, so Max, that is generally the kind of 18 to 23 year old age bracket who reported in the survey, and it was a sample of over 6,000 students. I mean, the 1 in 4 ballpark and the 1 in 10 of males having experienced sexual violence is pretty consistent globally, but it is a higher, a slightly higher percentage in this particular iteration or the time period that we're talking about. So.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Charlotte MacGyver. And thank you for your visiting. And the PhD students, you can stay a little bit. And she's so kind to agree to stay and chat with us.
Thank you.